Hi, I'm Jen Posner with the John DeBella Show on Philadelphia's Classic Rock 102.9 MGK. I'm also the St. Mary Mom, and it's a new month, so that means it's time for a new St. Mary Mom topic. And I'm here at St. Mary Medical Center in Langhorne once again. Specifically, we are in the Bristol-Myers Squibb Pediatric Emergency Room Center. And I have to say, I'm happy today to be here in a professional capacity. I've been here more times than I can count recently. We were here for a broken wrist for one of my children. We were here for severe dehydration from another stomach bug episode. So I'm happy to be here, like I said, in a professional capacity. And the last time I was here was when the center first opened. And it's really exciting as a resident of Lower Bucks County to have a facility such as this dedicated solely to the emergency care for pediatrics. And since the last time I was here, there have been some changes, some really exciting developments. There's a new partnership here at the ER between St. Mary and the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, which, of course, that's a name that everybody recognizes when it comes to top care for pediatrics. And I'd like to introduce you to somebody who's going to highlight those changes. And then we're also going to talk a little bit about influenza and children. So come on, let's go meet Dr. Mittal. I'd like to introduce you now to Dr. Manoj Mittal. He is Director of Pediatric Emergency Medicine here at St. Mary Medical Center. Doctor, thank you so much for taking the time to be with us here today. I know you have a busy schedule, so we'll get right to it. Exciting new things going on here at the Pediatric ER at St. Mary's. We now have a partnership between St. Mary Medical Center and Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, of course, the most coveted name of pediatric services in practically the entire country, if not the world, I would say. So it's wonderful that you're now a part of this hospital. Can you highlight some of the benefits of this partnership for us?
Sure. Thank you so much for having me. We are very excited at this. So the Children's Hospital is now providing medical staffing for the pediatric ED, and we started this partnership with effect from October 1st. As part of this partnership, we are going to have pediatricians and pediatric emergency medicine physicians providing care for the children at this center. The majority of children who come to the ED do so in the evening, so we'll have two physicians at that time. There'll be a pediatrician and a pediatric emergency medicine trained physician. For the rest of the time, mostly there'll be a pediatrician. And both pediatricians are specially trained in the care of children, and then the pediatric emergency medicine physicians do 3 more years of training to gain expertise in dealing with emergencies. Mm-hmm. We will also be using 3 of the rooms in our center. So this is, we like to call it a hybrid unit. Mm-hmm. So 3 of the 12 rooms can also be used for inpatient admissions.
Okay.
And to take care of inpatients, we need a pediatrician 24/7. And that is the service that we are now providing. So we won't have to transfer every kid who needs hospitalization to Children's Hospital or to St. Chris or to other, you know, institutions. So they can be taken care of right here in the community.
Yeah. So honestly, this is such an amazing hospital to have, you know, at our disposal, and to now have CHOP physicians here 24/7 is such an exciting development. You know, in the event that you do need to bring your children here, and I've done so quite a few times in the last couple of months. But one of the reasons I actually brought my daughter in a couple weeks ago, which I'm sure you're now starting to see, flu season, right? Flu season is now running October through May, roughly, is the flu season, right?
Yep. So, you know, that's the usual time. And this year, it's been a little bit slow. So far, flu hasn't really started in the U.S. Mm-hmm. And usually it peaks in January and February, and that is what we are anticipating for this year as well.
Okay.
And this gives us a little more window for those people who have not gotten their kids vaccinated yet. There is still time, so get your kids vaccinated. And, you know, the recommendation is from both the CDC as well as the American Academy of Pediatrics that all children from the ages of 6 months onwards should get vaccination every year.
But let's talk a little bit more about the flu in young children and the importance of having that vaccination, because, you know, adults, we have the ability to, I mean, the flu can knock, you know, a grown adult on their rear end for couple of days to a week, but children have a harder time dealing with it. So how dangerous can the flu be for young children?
So flu, you know, it's the extremes of ages that are affected by flu in a worse manner. So children below the ages of 5 years, and especially below the ages of 2 years, mm-hmm. are affected much more. They are much more likely to be hospitalized, more likely to get complications as compared to children older than 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So with regards to the flu vaccine that you mentioned now, I have three children from 3 to 7, and they've all been vaccinated for the flu this season. What is the challenge? Because the flu vaccine, or not the flu vaccine, but the flu itself changes from year to year, correct? The virus mutates, it changes.
Right.
So from the perspective of the medical profession, how do you prepare for that? And what are the exact benefits to getting the flu vaccine, say for somebody who isn't sure they want to have it?
Yeah. Last year, the flu vaccine that was given did not match with the circulating strains. Mm-hmm. This year, it is highly likely that the flu vaccine is going to match. So far, the reports are suggesting that it is more likely to match. And when the flu vaccine matches the circulating strains, then it is quite effective. And, you know, it'll reduce the disease incidence by about 50 to 60%.
Mm-hmm.
It is even more effective in reducing complications and reducing hospitalization, reducing death rates from mm-hmm. flu. So it is really important to get everybody vaccinated.
Okay, you get the flu vaccine. It's not guaranteed that it's going to, you know, prevent you from getting it, but it will help. What else can parents do to help reduce the risk of their child coming down with the flu?
Sure. So like we said, vaccination is the first tool, and then just, you know, maintaining good hygiene.
Mm-hmm.
For example, you know, if you know that somebody has flu in your family, in your household, somebody already has flu, you know, they should cover. And the best way is to use their sleeve and the elbow part whenever they are coughing, because the flu spreads by various mechanisms.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them is droplet spread. So somebody with flu, if they are coughing, if they are sneezing, if they are talking, then the flu virus can spread and mm-hmm. it can go to the other person's nose, throat, eyes, etc. The other mechanism is by contact.
Mm-hmm.
So if suppose I have flu and my nose has been running and I wipe it with my hands, and then I touch somebody else, you know, I touch you.
Right.
And then by chance, you know, you have an itch or something and you rub your nose with it, then that way it can be transmitted.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The other way is that if suppose, you know, I have flu on my hand and I touch the doorknob or something, and then you touch that doorknob. So that's how the virus can spread as well.
Right.
So maintaining cleanliness. If you are a mother of a child with one child having flu and with other children, wash your hands, you know, or use hand sanitizers between handling one child and the other.
Right.
Avoid sharing cups and utensils between them. You know, so
those are some good tips, because I always feel like as the mother of three, that is the hardest thing to do, is to, when one gets it, I swear, it's just inevitable. They're all going to come down with something. So let me ask you, you know, one of the other big challenges I've faced as a parent when I have to decide, do you take your child to the ER or not? You sit there, especially in the middle of the night, you're like, oh my gosh, do you want to make the trek over there? What do I do? Are they sick enough? Are they not sick enough? So if your child is exhibiting flu symptoms, when is the, how do you decide when is it time to take them to the emergency room?
Sure. So let us go over the symptoms of flu, you know, so that people know first, when is it likely to be flu? Flu can cause multiple symptoms. The commonest is fever.
Mm-hmm.
It can cause sore throat. It can cause cough. It can cause runny nose or rhinorrhea. It can cause, you know, tremendous amount of weakness or fatigue and malaise, so that even if you don't have fever, you just feel tired and mm-hmm. you don't have the energy to do anything. And sometimes the muscle aches can become even worse. So these are the common symptoms. Healthy children who do not have underlying illnesses, especially between the ages of 5 years to 18 years, 19 years, they are usually, you know, will get these symptoms for anywhere from 1 to 2 days to sometimes 5 to 6 days,
mm-hmm.
but then they get better.
Mm-hmm.
The other key thing is that usually a good thing to watch for is when the child has fever, he's going to look upset, you know, tired, sleepy. But then as the fever comes down, whether because you gave the child some Tylenol or on its own, the child should perk up, should give you smiles, you know, should be happy, should be able to feed something. So if all those things are happening, the child is continuing to feed, continuing to drink, then mm-hmm. you can watch the child at home. But if your child has underlying illnesses, because that's another reason for complications besides the age, you know, they are immunocompromised, they have underlying asthma,
mm-hmm.
because flu can precipitate asthma. If they have sickle cell disease, if they have cystic fibrosis, if they have underlying learning difficulties, cerebral palsies, they are ventilator dependent. So any of those categories of children are much more likely to get complications.
Mm-hmm.
And those children you should bring to the doctor right away.
Mm-hmm.
Because the sooner you start anti-flu, so we haven't touched upon it, but there are some specific medications as well that we can use to treat flu.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the earlier those medications are started, the better they work.
Okay.
So, you know, bring the child for those
So when
things,
in doubt, always call your physician,
yes.
or if it's
yes.
not, you're not in a setting where you can reach your physician, that's also a case too, to head over to the emergency room. All right, Dr. Manoj Mittal, thank you so much for some great tips and information about flu. Hopefully you make it through flu season and don't have to show up at the ER, but if you do, this is the place to be, of course, at the Bristol-Myers Squibb Pediatric Emergency Care Center here at St. Mary Medical Center. We'll see you next month. Happy New Year.